So I am Mary Sutton. I'm the Education Director and Community Engagement Director at the school. So I'm starting with this as a slide to give you the context in which I work, right? But this is actually what I do. I apply theater in multiple contexts. To give you a little story about that, when I said I was hired to come and redo the education department at the Alley, and I said, we're changing the name to Applied Theater at the Alley, and my boss, I answered to the managing director, not to the artistic director. My boss said, no one knows what that is. In fact, he did not know what that is. And so we added a tagline to it so that everybody could go, oh, that means this. That means education and community engagement. But I didn't want to back down from that. Mm-hmm. And so we just kept it, slowly kept it. And now board members know what it is. Everybody is beginning to accept it. And then when they did the new mission and core values, of which nobody was involved, to give you an idea of this institution, they had a core value of community engagement, which blah, 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 blah. And then the last one was applied theater, which means to my boss, who defined this, integrating drama, education, community, drama in education, community, or therapeutic programs, right? It, like, he finally got it. I tell you that, yes, I come from the Alley. If you have not heard, we had a flood. We had a hurricane, and then we had another hurricane, which was the retirement of Greg Boyd. So we are now rudderless in terms of artistic decisions, but that is an opportunity for the organization to remake itself. And I see that as a new beginning for what I do in the organization. I think of myself as the entrepreneurial part of the organization. When I started to define it that way, people started to go, oh. And I took it when I was hired, as a mandate to create whatever I wanted to create. And I think of myself as a little startup organization. Everything that we do is a startup. And in that context, that's how I sort of function. Now, we are going to create a framework, or we're going to start to create something that looks like that with what we do. And when I said I was going to do this, I had no idea that, as I ruminated on it, that it was a bigger challenge than I had sort of thought. Mm-hmm. I mean, I thought it was a big challenge, but then I started to really ruminate it, I think, for the last 2 weeks. I am a person who needs contemplation time, and I have a job in which I get none. Mm-hmm. So I was carving out time on the weekends and everything, and how do we do this? Mm-hmm. So I am presenting to you something that I want you to think of as very boots on the ground. It is not theory. It is not, I've tried not to use lingo. I've tried to be very, I come from a family of engineers. I've tried to be very down on the ground with where we want to go with this whole discussion. And that 45 minutes of it is you guys helping me figure out how we build a collective framework. So I've included some cool pictures. We at the Alley, about 3 years ago, we started working with a slam poet in Houston and brought slam poetry. We were already doing slam poetry with kids, and someone called me and said, can you do a big slam poetry, adult slam poet spectacle at the Alley? And they had never done it. Again, I'm giving you context. And everybody went, whoa, where do we put it? How do we do this, right? And I'm like, we'll do it, we'll take care of it, and then you just come to see it. This Saturday will be our fourth slam poetry. We have kids slam poetry yesterday, teens, and then we'll have the adult slam tonight, and we bring them in from all over the country. And it was a game changer for our theater. We moved it to the main stage 2 years ago, but we found that the main stage was too big, mm-hmm. and so we moved it back to our... So this was a big, diverse move, guys, for the Alley Theater. We also have done a lot of work with VSA. This is our collective that we're working with, right? Mm-hmm. And then we did the Telling Project. Has anybody heard of the Telling Project? It's a group, they were out of Boston, and they come in and they work with vets in your community. Mm-hmm. They help them write their stories, and then they present them. Again, my theater was like, what? You're gonna bring that, and they're gonna stand, and we have a sort of an event space that we use as a third space because we're usually full on our main stage and our our black box. So we do this in an event space, and vets come and they tell their stories. This was a couple; they were both vets, and they were talking about how they met. So these are just some of the things that I've had to create because they did not have these things in the last 5 years. I just want to draw your attention to the little girl up there. She's five. We worked with a genetics department in Herman Memorial. Houston, if you don't know, is a big, it's like, MD Anderson is there. We have 26 hospitals in 15, blocks. It's a huge medical city. Anyway, she is drawing a picture of her brother who died of the same genetic disease that she has. So that was one of the programs, and this is an online resource that we put out to schools when we do our character education series. So here's our what we're going to be doing. And though I say that we want to stay down on the ground when we're talking about criteria of how our work fits together, I want us to think metacognitively. And in the middle, I want to leave the theory to the side. And the reason I want to do that is when I started to think about doing this session. It was so large to try to pin it down, and I'm sure you probably have been through this process with it was so large, and I kept hoping that they would give me another person to work with so that I could have someone to bounce ideas off of. And finally, I think 2 days before I flew here, I brought in my executive manager, and I said, you gotta help me brain dump with this, because I can't separate the individual work that I have done from the idea of where I'm going. So I've thrown that out, and I am actually going to tell you a story about myself, and it's not so that you, I want you to know me, that's great, that's warm and fuzzy, but I've had a journey, and it's been a long one. I started doing this work in New York City in the mid-80s. And some of you might recognize yourself in my journey. So I just want to encapsulate sort of where I'm going with this in little nuggets that are personal to me, and then hopefully we can extrapolate. I feel like sometimes that I'm going out on a limb with this, but I thought about it last night after I listened to Carmen. And I sat there and I watched the group, and I had this amazing moment. I think the first time I was in a group of people that were doing this kind of work, and we didn't call it EDI, we didn't call it community engagement, those labels weren't there. They weren't there until maybe 10, 15 years ago. And I realized that there, I had not seen a group of community engagement practitioners. There's a lot of names you can call that, call us, ever. There, in 1991, Alternate Roots in Atlanta, Georgia, had a group, a convening of people who were trying to bridge the aesthetics of the art world to the aesthetics of the community. And so I went home last, I mean, I'm sick, as you guys can notice. And I went to the Plaza Hotel, and I changed this presentation a little bit based on what she said. And I realized that I have to tell my own story. And in that, there's maybe some coat hangers we can hang on to, hang on some stuff. And then hopefully you guys will have your own stories when we're gonna do a process together that you will start to cogitate on. So I'm gonna pause this here. Go. Okay, that's the slam poetry. We'll just leave that out for a second. So I realized when I went, I said, okay, what do all my projects, if we're gonna have a framework, we have to, and a common language, which I have never seen happen. Everybody talks about this work differently, and they have different words for it, and different language for it, and us older folk have a whole generation of language around it. I sometimes listen to the new language, and I have to go, what does that mean, or, oh, that's a good way of saying that, and then I go, and then I'll go, is that really what they're talking about? Right? So anyway, I was listing all of my projects going, what do they have in common? And, well, I've got to figure out who I'm working with, and I've got to, well, how much time do I have, and how much funding do I have? Right? And then I said, well, what about that other project that I did? And that other, so I started doing cultural community animation. I was graduated from NYU. I'll give you the 5-minute overview. Trained to be an actress in New York, NYU, fabulous program. And I got sick, very sick, ended up on a cancer ward at Roosevelt Hospital, and totally changed my perspective of my work. Now, mind you, I wasn't a Broadway type. I had been exposed to downtown theater, and that was where my heart lived. Right, so I was already in an experimental place, and I graduated from the experimental theater wing at NYU, so I was in that place, right? So when I got out, my first piece that I made was, we had a little company, we stood on the corner of 9th Street and 1st Avenue, next to the Asian fruit stand, because he was the only one that would let us, you'd plug all the camera work. This is like mid-80s, right? And we interviewed people who walked by what they thought God was. And then we interspersed those interviews, and we did 2 days of them, and I still have them, and they're amazing. And we interspersed that into a piece that we made for a gallery, didn't we, right? So I realized last night, that was my first community engagement. Also my first working with virtual and tech and all of that stuff, but that was in the 80s, right? And then I went to the ART in that program, was a director in the ART Institute, blah, 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 blah. And it was so hierarchical. It's like, this is high training, and this is low training, and this is how we do it, and our work is important work. And you know what? It is. Some of it is. It wasn't diverse. It was highly skilled, beautiful work, right? And then when I got out, I was so tired and so exhausted. A friend of mine said, come down to the, and we'll work in the rural arts program. And South Carolina had gotten a big grant from the NEA, yes. There were times when the NEA did this, and they gave money out for people to go and work in rural settings. So from the ART, I went to James Island in South Carolina, where they speak Gullah. And my first job was in a cafeteria with 16 African-American students who still lived in the houses that their slave grandparents lived in. They had outhouses, right? They did not know theater, and they watched soap operas, and I had to teach theater to them, and it was the awakening moment that I had. And I bet you all have had that moment. I want you to think about that moment for yourself. Right? We've all had that moment or we wouldn't be in this room. And I said to myself, what am I going to do? I mean, there was macaroni and cheese on the floor, right? What am I going to make? You know, how do I find common ground? And at a certain point, I said, do you guys go to church? And they you know, in the cafeterias where they have the three steps? They got on the three steps in voice order, and they literally serenaded me for about 20 minutes in four-part harmony. So I said, we're going to do a Greek play, right? And these kids had never been to a theater. They'd never, you know, they watched soap operas. So we make, that's why Greek, right? Big themes, and right? They loved it, and they had to go to a competition. And of course, Charleston, South Carolina, you have the public schools, and then you have the Catholic school. I mean, the religious schools. One group is in the public school, and another group is in, you know, so it was black and white. And white troop after white troop after white troop came into this competition, and my kids came up, right? And of course they didn't win. Of course they didn't. And I am sure it was racist, right? And it broke my heart, and I think that was the moment where I said I wasn't going to turn around and go back into mainstream theater. So I ended up working in the Rural Arts Initiative for 8 years. And I did work with James City, which was the first African-American community. It's where the black slaves came when they were free. And that Duke had documented their ancestors, so we could trace their oral histories all the way from 1860 something or other all the way up to current times. So we took white members of the community and black members of the community, and we made a piece. It was like amazing. Then I ended up in Palo Alto, California, in a theater. Now I want you to, who has crossed over from being an individual artist doing this kind of work to being now in an institution? And I say that because there was a time when institutions didn't even have education departments. Zippo, right? They might be making money off of camps. Mm-hmm. And they might be doing classes, but they're definitely not reaching out to their communities because they're the White House on the Hill, right? So then they all were like, we got to have education departments. So those of us that were doing the work, up we stood, we'll be that, right? And then you run into institutions. I ended up in Palo Alto, California. Palo Alto, California, if no one knows it, is very white on one side of 101 and very diverse on the other side of 101. You go to Palo Alto High School, and it's like a private school, it's a public school, and you literally go a mile across 101 and you are in a community that does not have a high school at all and buses its kids 45 minutes away. Whose elementary schools don't have proper electricity. who are being barraged by charter schools coming in, right? And this is all established because of redlining and, you know, blah, 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 blah. I mean, I could go into that. I mean, it's important stuff, but it's a rabbit hole that it's so vast that I don't want to. So I spent almost 10 years exploring that divide of 101. We worked with Fences. And my theater allowed me to do a lot of community engagement projects. We did a Joy Luck Club Bridges project, and we brought all this into the theater. We got oral histories. We gave them cameras. They documented them, you know. So it was all wonderful stuff. Did it change the people who came to our theater? Maybe that much. Maybe that much. And it costs money, right? So I started to rethink, why are we doing this? I know why I want to do it, but why? What does it mean? Is it, if it doesn't, you know, if I was integrated in the community in East Palo Alto, I knew the schools, I knew the social service agencies, but at the same time, why? So I'm bringing that question up to us as a group. We all are on the bandwagon, but I think there has to be a moment when you ask yourself a very personal question. In order to stay on it, you know, in order to stay moving forward, right? So we started a children's healing project, all of that stuff. So I learned a lot during that time on how to make successful, long, enduring projects, how to create long, successful relationships, how to figure out how to make a program that suited the theater but also would have longevity in the community. Right, it was always a balancing act of going from the theater world into the community world and trying to figure out how do I be that bridge, right? And then the alley called, and I was 15 years in Palo Alto, and I knew the alley's reputation. It's what, the sixth largest theater in America. We have an $18 million budget. And they had two education people. They didn't raise a lot of money for their education department, interestingly enough. And so when Dean said, how would you define yourself? And I said, what I do is artistic. Everybody's nodding. But he went, sure. But within the first year, I realized that he had no idea what I was talking about when I said, what I do is an art form. Right? And Greg, who's now no longer there, was like, you're smart enough, just do it, it's great. You know, and we're over here and we do the art. You do the education and the community engagement. So I found myself, and I took the job, I think, because I had learned a lot, and I'm like, what good is my work that I've done if I am not in an institution like that trying to change it from the inside out? Mm-hmm. I can keep doing projects, and that's great, but I think there, before I die and I'm older, what do I want to stand for? Well, the change is not going to happen unless those institutions change. First of all, I need to understand that institution, and second of all, then I need to know how to maneuver in that world, right? And so the last 5 years I've been at the Alley. I did manage to get something like this. That's Ed Mayberry from Atlanta. That's Rain. She's our slam poet. She works with all of our residencies in our partner school program. They range from Sharpstown, which is probably 95% Latino, 5% Black, all the the way up to St. Francis that had to sit down and talk about race when she came into the classroom, right? She's a phenomenal poet. And then, come on. And then we have Seth, who is an Austin poet, and he came in and did a whole bunch of teaching for us. My boss watching this, oh my God, I wish I had taken a picture. Right? And he was uncomfortable. He was, especially, he watched Ed, right? And Ed's powerful. He's from Atlanta, and he's like an international slam. I mean, and he's a powerful man, saying a powerful thing, you know? And my boss, who is probably a little, he calls himself an old white guy, and he sees that, he'll know that, he says, I'm just an old white guy, right? And he watched this, and I think it was a dawning on him, right? And the next time he let us be on the main stage, which of course I don't think was the right move for us. Again, we learn as we go. So that was the first thing, and it went all great. Everybody came. Our New Works people were like, we want these poets in our New Works, whatever. And they did. They brought Zangu. We brought a hip-hop piece to our main stage the next year because they were so affected by this. So yes, I made some change, right? So off I went, right? And we do have a lot of education programs, so I'm doing all this along. So now we're at where I had to go up a little in my thinking, right? I knew how to do this, I made it happen. And now I want us together to go up a little in our thinking because I slammed against the power structure after this. I don't know why. I'm not going to make any judgments on that. We have 140 employees. We are in a constant mode of fundraising. I have now 9 employees, you know, in my department. I mean, but bang, you weren't going to go any farther than that. They did. We haven't established an EDI. But Greg was there, and Greg was, what was that scenario this morning, where we would hire diverse people if they would audition, and if they were out there, and if they were, and what about, and we've got a company, and I've got, you know, there was not a lot of will to make any other change. This was nice. We all recognize that. So, as we encountered, this is going to be important, as we moved into our next thing, right? No one knew who was responsible for anything, right? If we're going to have slam poets, who's going to market them? And if we're going to have talkbacks, does the artistic own that? Does, you know, it was like the whole organization was in a tizzy, right? Because they had been doing things, this power structure. And I'm making like tiny steps. I'm not making big steps here. I'm talking tiny, 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 right? So we had to define these things because everybody, marketing people were doing community engagement when we sell group tickets. you know, and it's like no one, I mean, you know, and they all have their audience, everybody's talking about these terms, right? And no one in the organization, big or small, knows anything. So, and I've got handouts we'll give you. So we defined it. It's faulty. We said, what is audience development, what is audience engagement, and what is community engagement, right? Those are our three things. And then this was the line that had the most pushback on it. Who is the primary owner of each of those things? And it's permeable. we really had to establish something in our organization. I don't know if you've done this in your organizations, but we found it gave somebody, everybody who was going, something to hang on to, right? So, and the long-term objective for all of us, and I'm being very boots on the ground about this. I'm not being theoretical. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying equity and diversity and inclusion. I'm being where my institution lives, which is money. They want to make art, yes. I don't want to put that down. Yes, they want to make art. But they think about money, and they have to think about money, and there is nothing wrong with that. So we just, we're blatantly honest about, we want to build audience size. We want audience participation and loyalty. We want to have someone subscribe, right? And we want strong two-way relationships within the community. And they didn't have that happening so much. And it's grown a lot. The Alley is beloved in Houston, so people know about it. I didn't have to struggle with anything there, but it isn't a place that some of the organizations that should think it's their home know about. They know about it, but they don't know about it, right? So then we added this. So for instance, the marketing, when we want to develop audience, we are focusing on increasing attendance numbers from existing and new groups and building membership numbers. I mean, this is very, there's no warm and fuzzy about this. This is in the speak that the marketing department and the board can understand, mm-hmm. right? So this doesn't break down all of our programs. It just gave them an idea. So, flow of conversation. This was very important for people to understand that the institution to potential audiences. And then over here, artist institution to audience, audience to artist institution, audience to audience inside the theater. Right? And then who's outside? It's community engagement. This seems, if you have ever worked in a large organization, people think they understand this. People think they know this, right? But they don't, right? There's these lines where, you know, the group sales guy thinks one thing, and it's never been defined, right? And if you don't have a common language or something common to look at, this gray area, I'm not responsible for that, and who's gonna take care of that? And do our production people have to, you know, this became a tool. I will tell you that my boss disregarded this and we still use it, and he was run around because he said the primary beneficiary of any of this is not the organization, it's the community. Think about that. He's not wrong in an old way of thinking about things. The old way of thinking, and he mansplained to me a good half an hour about this, and I backed off. I just said, okay, I'm not gonna, you know, I have certain fights I'm gonna fight. And I'm like, but this is, we are all about the audience. That should be something that's a circle here. But I think you have to be honest with yourselves about this one, that you want butts and seats, and you need that. Those you need that. Just do. But it gave me an insight into him, which is he really does believe that he's Superman, and the arts organization is out there creating the culture. Right? He truly believes that. And that is a way of thinking that hasn't been challenged. And there are multiple theaters like this in America that have still not been, we are growing, and they are not in this room. They are not in this room. So that is why I think building a common framework is important to us. Because you have an artistic director, you have an artistic director or whatever, they're not thinking in a unified way about this. They are just saying that's community, right? And they think it's good and it brings money, but it's still over here because they're not in these conversations. How do we get them here? Well, we have to unify. And in order to unify, we have to have a unified language. I am on a mission here. And I have this handout for you. I don't know, has anybody done anything like this at their institution? You might have done something like that. You've done that?
It's similar to this.
You got one? Did it change your conversation?
Well, I'm realizing that I share my NERPI matrix with my staff. And I'm sure that in some kind of conversation I had with the larger team, might have shared it with them. But mostly it was an internal document, so we knew what was going on. And it was like, oh, we're doing so many programs. These are the ones that are motivated from the community. The community wants this thing to happen, and then we tap in on it. These are the ones that are motivated from the organization wanting to do something. But it was a lot of the same communication and the same kind of communication touch points, same kind of decision-making touch points, and the same clarity about who held the power in what rooms.
Yes.
But ultimately, we always knew that everything was serving the organization or we wouldn't be doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yours?
It was part of a strategic plan where I work at the Santa Fe Opera, and every department had to do one. And I shook my head when you said, I agree with you when you said that it had to be artistic, because they want their education programs to actually have just as high of an artistic value as it was on the main stage. Like it wasn't already, like, no. Like, do you have any idea what we're already doing? No, you don't.
No, they don't.
So once they realized that they actually wanted to evaluate that with us and they started doing that, they're like, wow.
Yeah. Well, that's why I take pictures like that.
But we kept them with us, and we actually have a leadership transition happening with them here. I think will actually be quite good. But it is starting to stick in the culture of the company.
Great. Anybody else have documents sort of like this, and has it changed the, at least cleared up some,
yeah,
or created some openings?
It's cleared up. I mean, I think we stopped at how we define it. Like, we decided, like, we call it buckets of community engagement, and it's like cultivation, enhancement, and partnerships, which is the same thing, but we didn't, it all exists in community engagement, which we felt like this has an arm in marketing and artistic and education, but our engagement, which is now artist development, actually existed and has always existed since I've been in the marketing department. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. See, I think that's one of the shifts that's happening these days is I think that people are realizing that education and community engagement or community engagement or whatever is not marketing.
Yeah.
But you see, I think it's a slow dawning for many people who work in our theaters, right? This wasn't for my department to understand. It was for the rest of the theater to understand, right? So, so we did that, and my boss came to me and said, "We are the second largest Hispanic Latinx community in the United States, second to LA." And the LA has tried many, many, many strategies to reach out to the Latinx community in Houston. none of them have worked very well. They have worked a little bit, right? So he said, we're gonna do this thing called Remote Houston. So people started in, we call it the, I get the words mixed up. I'm gonna use this because it's a way to talk about it, the Fifth Ward. They have different wards, it's a little like Louise, New Orleans, but which is primarily Hispanic. And so the people, the audience would come and get a headset, and they would walk around the city. And it started in a graveyard in the Fifth Ward. And then for an hour, they walked through the city and stood and watched subway or buses go by, and not subway, rail go by, and then they would do certain things. And they ended up in way at the top of Houston, which is all about community. It was all looking at what do you see on the street and whatever. And that was his first outreach into the community. But it was still not about the community. It was about what we wanted to bring to the community. Mm-hmm. Right? So he then approached me and said, we want to bring Mesa Fronteriza, which means border mass. It's a group from Monterrey, Mexico. And they are going to, they don't speak English. And they're going to come, and we've written a grant, and the mayor's office has funded it, and we're gonna do this whole thing for the Latinx community. And I went, wait a minute, right? that's not going to happen. And so I convinced him that we wrote a placemaking grant from the NEA, and it's like and. Always talking about it, we're bringing in Mesa Fronteriza and we're doing some community engagement around it. How many of you have been in that position? Right? We're bringing in the art and we're gonna do some community engagement, and they say that, right? Now, he is a well-meaning and well-intentioned man. And it is a great show. And it's all in Spanish, and we have a translation, simultaneous translation. There's the show. It's all about the border. And they make a border, and they explore what border means. And I said, we have to go out. We have to make friends with certain organizations, and we have to go into those organizations and have them write their stories. Right, so we are in the middle of this process. We have a team of teaching artists, which is one is Latino and one is on our staff, because we didn't want to make the Latino teaching artists learn all of the curriculum and feel they needed to feel supported. And we're in, I think, 8 sites. And the community is writing their stories, and they will also perform their stories at the same time. This is happening. That was David, one of our teaching artists, working. We're in, and then I know this feels culturally out of place, because Mesa Fronteriza is about ranchera music. I made a stipulation that we have an advisory committee. An advisory team that is Latinx from the community, and this was their welcome reception. So the whole project is called El Zocalo Mesa Fronteriza. That is a man that's on the advisory team talking about what El Zocalo is in Mexico. Has anybody been to the El Zocalo in Mexico? Can you tell them what it's like?
It's like a plaza. It's in Mexico City, and it's very Spanish.
And lots of things come together in that space. So hopefully we're gonna build that, right? Are we successful? No. we have lots of people writing stories, and we have lots of advisory team members right? But we are making about that much of an impression. And my boss is really upset about that, right? And I said, we have to be doing this project 3 to 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a baby step in trying to figure out the next steps that might happen.
What is exactly 3 to 5 years?
The project. And I'm saying this because it's the duration of a project is important.
Even though it's related to a play called Isa.
The play will go off and then we will keep the Al Zocalo part of it and we will bring in another play or we will bring in another American company or we will create something ourselves.
Every
year.
Mm-hmm.
So that the relationships deepen and deepen and deepen,
mm-hmm.
right? Because we're not going to do something in a year. Okay, so there's my story from individual artist to I get all my tools and now I'm in a big arts organization that I want to be making more change, but I'm changing it as I go and it's modified. So I'm sitting here going, do we make a rubric?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So hopefully you've been thinking as I've been thinking, oh, I did that project. And I did that project, or I work with that group, or I work with that kid group. Are we doing something that says, I just brought up some rubrics and some logic models that we've used at the theater. Are we doing something like this?
Mm-hmm.
And what would these categories be?
Mm-hmm.
Right? I don't know. I have a tendency to think that this is something we might be doing. This is a logic model. It filled out for a project that we're doing with the Menninger Clinic about social emotional learning and arts in the classroom in Blackshear Elementary, which is a Title I campus that is on the verge of being closed down because they don't have high enough test scores. They also need mental health practitioners. Anyway, it's mental. It's so that I think is something valuable. If we wanted to figure out a common framework. I don't know that we would do that, but what are the resources you're allocating? What are the main activities you are performing? What are the outputs of your activities? And that's the process. And then what your audience learns from the activities, what action will they take, and what impact will that action have? I think that's valuable, but I don't know how. And I'm putting it in your hands because we're going to do a brain dump. So I went ahead and said, okay, of all those projects that I've told you about, what are the common factors that I talked to my executive manager and I said, you got to help me. I don't think we're doing a logic model. I don't know what we're doing, but I know we need common language. And she said, what do you go through, what's the checklist you go through in your head when you are making a project? Whether it's with a hospital and healing, whether it's with the Latinx community, whether it's an education program, whether it's with special needs kids, whether it's at the hospital, what? And these are not all of them. And I'm not using politically correct terminology. I'm just using structural, boots on the ground, engineering, right? And there's more here. I wanted to start, these are seeds, right? So I think about the duration. It's important to think about the funding. In that is, do you need a return on investment? Does it have to be self-sustaining?
Mm-hmm.
Or do you have to have that funding like on my healing project at Lucille Packard Children's Hospital? I knew I had the funding for that year after year until they did this, that family foundation was gone, right? Place, are you in your community, in community and arts organization, in the arts organization? Are you published? Are you virtual? These are all from my own experience, so I'm hoping that when I gave you that long preamble, you've been going, oh, I had that project. Oh, I had that project. Oh, she, you know. Manpower, I'm sorry, I used manpower. People power. Arts organization employees, are you using your own employees? Are you using community members? This is to do it, to actually do it, right? A combination of those two. Do you need outside expertise? Do you need specialized professionals? Is training necessary to do this? Is it multidisciplined? A lot of my projects before I, well, still is, were visual arts as well as, or photography as well as, or written paper and all of that stuff. And then process, is it within the community, on site? Where is it? Is it multi-site? Where, you know, these are all things that we actually, way in the back of our heart, when we're making up a program, we think of this stuff, but we don't know we're thinking of it, I think. Maybe I'm wrong. And then populations, are we hitting family, kids, adults? Are we dealing with gender? Are we dealing with multi-generations? Are we dealing with something that's heritage or cultural? Are we social group specific? Ladies with red hats when we have the we're doing crowns? Are we dealing with a racial group? What are we dealing with, right? And then, what's our purpose? Healing, building relationships, giving voice, barrier busting, creating dialogue, constructing entry points, artistic expression, welcome or an introduction, historic documentation. Dreams Like Steel, it was all based on historic documentation of the families, you know, in James City. Creating current events, resonance. I couldn't figure out a nice way of saying, so in other words, are we having a political discussion? But I don't want to say that because then we're, is that, do we want to just say we're having political discussions or are we doing something bigger than that? I don't know. That's a question I'm asking you guys. Is your purpose education? Is your purpose cultural celebration? These are not the only things. These are just my limited brainstorming. So, what I want you to do is, it's after lunch, I can tell everybody wants to move. Break into groups of four, I think that might work, four or five. And I'm gonna hand out, there's markers up here. The other will kind of hand the other to you guys. Meaning, what have we left out in this, what have we left out? Population, who wants to make a list of what have we left out with population? Or what do we want to call it? Working, what do we want? What's the real term that we use when we talk about population that we're working with? What more do we want to add to that in terms of criteria? So does somebody want to grab that?
Sure.
Yeah. Duration. Does someone want to grab this? I'm going to give these. You're all looking at me like. Brainstorm on duration. Have I hit everything, or do we want to add something to that? Process. Give process over here. There you go. People power. Place and people power. I'm going to give people power over here. Place. There you go. So what are the categories? If we were to have a unified way of talking about what we do, what are the categories that, the metacognitive categories, that you're all looking at me like I'm a little, need some explanation? No, you good? How about you guys do funding? So if we were to say, here's our rubric. Here's our rubric for community engagement in America in 2018. Given the language that we have, what more criteria would we want to add to, let's say, a rubric? Or a logic model, or whatever. What's the language we want to use?
Can I ask a clarifying question?
Yeah.
Is the goal of the rubric to evaluate the program, or
no.
Is the goal of the rubric just to describe it to someone else?
The goal of the rubric is to describe it to someone else. Maybe there's a way to evaluate it. I don't know. Maybe there's a way that you can talk about it that says, I'm doing this to do this, and it'll have these outcomes. Right? So it's for us to come up with a common language so that we all know we're doing a long sustaining project in a community of adults or whatever word we come up with that has earned income and it return on investment is not necessary. So that we have something that we can start to go, oh, she's doing the same kind of project that I'm doing. Right? It's not just theoretical. It's very engineer-like. It's very boots on the ground. Go for it.
I'm going to sit on the floor here. It just makes more sense.
For you,
I feel like I should play some music.
Of course, we have a soft voice.
I know, it's hard.
You can keep playing from your computer if you want to. You should just go ahead and play. Want those because.
Okay.
What?
Our
I know.
What I'm saying, so, like, are we talking about this?
Mom, dad,
yeah.
Dad.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I should just compensate.
We do a lot.
It doesn't matter.
What matters? If we want to have a unified language, how much detail do we need? No, your expectation.
Well,
So what's the criteria for
in kind of
is it like if you require a particular
sort of more like just in entry
because you said in Houston,
and we also ban the common
Our vision tries to take like,
there are,
it's more of like coming under the label, but that like, there's,
it feels like populations is about being out of the and the man power is
these are cool.
So, let's come back.
This is the kind of conversation.
You have to go if you wait. She can help you. I'm handed that one.
So let's come back. So I think I've opened the can of worms.
Yep.
Yep. I did, and that was my goal.
Okay.
Can I ask my friends here to share the conversation that we're having? I would be a bit of a devil's advocate with them. It's not easy. I realize, and it's totally not easy, but it's necessary. I feel that we as a group of community practitioners in the Midlands of England, they called it cultural animators. I think it behooves us to find a common language that may not get down to the deepest detail of our work, but is some common bridge that we can share when we talk about what we're doing. Right? So over here, my friends were talking. Could you want to share a little bit about what you were? They've got a perspective.
Well, I will kick us off because I feel like I was one that was like, both those boxes are purple. Are they really the same box? What are we doing?
No, I'm sorry.
But you can see I like purple, though. This is partially coming from purple.
I love purple as well. We were
thinking about this as, in the process of creating this work, isn't everybody a collaborator? I feel like that word came from you, Katie, where it's like, everybody's a collaborator from the people who are deciding the things going to be created, even though they never enter the creation space, the folks who are funding that space, creating mandates for that space, the folks who are in the space making it, which includes a lot of us, sometimes people who are thought leaders, sometimes people who are actual practitioners, right? And then you've got the last pool of collaborators, which is your folks who are audiencing. And sometimes we're asking them or requesting that they audience in specific ways. Sometimes we're curating that group so that the huge performative thing we're doing together. So it felt like all of those boxes were important boxes to meditate on. We never got to what boxes were missing, though, because we got very...
So tell us, they have some, everybody's got, I know there's huge boxes missing, and everything has to be relabeled. But I also know that it's not an easy thing to do, is to find a common language. So go ahead and share what you came up with.
So some of the categories of collaborators that we broke down were that helped us to think critically and intentionally about some of the ways in which power flows through these collaborative community engagement processes. So thinking about looking at the box labeled manpower and the box labeled populations, that seems to break down in any project. There are some people who are participating and they are compensated for it. There are some people who are participating and they are not compensated for it financially. Some people are paying to participate. Those might be donors. Those might be students paying tuition. Mm-hmm. Some people are paid to participate. Sometimes that's a symbolic payment. Sometimes that's a full salary that's really enough to support a life. That's not an even playing field. Who has the power to make decisions? So where does decision-making power lie? And in any given project that's not a given that the power to make decisions always comes from the same place.
And where would those, do we add another category? Do the who's getting paid go into the, maybe funding is not the right word, right? How does money flow? The money flow, I don't know. Let's go over here to funding really quick. We're running out of time, but.
Sure, so we focus on contributed and earned income being two sort of big umbrellas, that there's a lot of things that are underneath those two that aren't listed on there. And something we talked a lot about was that you have, especially under contributed, right, you have foundations and government grants, things like that, corporate sponsorships, in-kind, right? So what kind of resources are you given? And then we also talked a lot about this idea of time and whether it's employees or people that come from the outside that are volunteering their time or their expertise, how that plays into it and how it's difficult to quantify that and how tensions can lie in that when you're building new programs or you're strengthening existing programs. And how that contributed funding, right? Because that's time that you could be paying someone. Can you pay those people? Do you not even discuss paying, right? So how does that happen? And then earned income, ticket sales, tuition, membership and subscriptions, concessions, merch, rental, sort of those tangibles. But we talked a lot about the idea of time and volunteering and expertise and the intangible and how do you suss that out?
And we didn't really get to the return on investment because mm-hmm. we didn't really know what to do with that. Is it really that it's meant to be self-sustaining? Is it that you're going for a multi-year grant? Is it, you know, is it, we just weren't quite sure what return on investment meant in this, because every project is so different, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Back there, we're running out of time, so I want to.
So we came up with a number of different answers for the topic.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not sure you guys can see it, but I'll read them all off. First, impact, output, outcome, justice, language / accessibility, representation / power distribution, and evaluation / feedback. and so these are the things that we came up with about. I'll go through some of the comments that we have.
We don't have any, but we'll just continue.
This impact, like desired outcome, a lot of times we're talking about community engagement, sometimes there is, we don't talk about what that is, especially when it comes to even feedback as well, just to figure out what was the outcome, what was the reflection for that, to make sure that we have that as part of the process when we're talking about what we're doing, to be able to assess, reevaluate, pivot if you need to. Justice, which I guess that goes along the same lines of healing as well. We were talking about earlier in that keynote, making sure justice is part of that as well. I'll stop there if you don't want to talk.
Yeah.
I want to just do this. Wait a minute. Go, is it going? It's not going. Yep.
It's not moving. My question to you now is, as we can tell, this is not easy. It's really not going to be easy. And so my question is, what's next? Right, if we were to continue this conversation and next year or in 6 months, release a rubric, a something or other, what would that look like? And how would we go about continuing this conversation? Would it be a rubric? Would it be a list?
And who do we invite to that conversation?
We started it here, so let's just start where we are, right? Does anybody want to jump in and say, hey, I'll take these, I mean, I'm gonna take two, and try to make sense out of everything that we've put up here and actually form a committee to say we're gonna end up making, like teaching artists, way back when Eric Booth had us do a rubric, which I resisted terribly, about what success looks like in teaching artistry. I didn't, you know, I was like, it's too much, right? But I really think that we're at an impasse now where if we have a common language, we are going to make a dent in the power struggle, I mean, the structure, much stronger than if we don't have a common language. So does anybody want to work with me in order to sort of maybe make sense out of and change these up so that they actually describe what we're talking about? One, two, three, four. We need one more person. Great. What we're going to do then is we're going to take all of this. This was a seed And the only seed I could think of as I went, what are the very basic details that we can jump off from? Please feel free to reach out to one of us or myself, and we will have some, I think, phone calls about how do we put something together that people will then look at and go, that's not right, or that's right, collaborate on in order to come up with some kind of unified, beginning of a unified language, right? And I think it has to start small, and I think then it has to grow. So that's my, yes, we've got to go. So everybody, I do, if you want to contemplate some of this stuff, I have handouts of just this slide, of just this slide, of just this slide, of just this slide.